go a step further and claim that the notion of happiness itself is very ambiguous in its implications. Let me give you a couple, maybe you know some of them, I apologize in advance, examples. I was, maybe I even used this story here 10 years ago. I was some 15, 20 years ago, I think it was Lithuania, Vilnius, their capital, and we debated when are people happy. And we came to a nice unequivocal result. Czechoslovakia, in those darkest Husak years, you know, in 68 they had almost this democratic socialism, it was crushed by the Soviet intervention, and then they had those 10, 15 years of so-called renormalization. Why were people, one can seriously claim, happy there? Three conditions, I claim. We establish them. First, for happiness, your material needs should be basically satisfied. Basically satisfied, but not too satisfied. If you get, for example, coffee all the time in the supermarkets, you get used to it, no? It must be like that once a month you don't get coffee, because this makes you aware all the other days how lucky you are to have it. And this was exactly the situation there. People lived a safe life. It was a kind of a modest welfare society with limitations, which precisely reminded you how happy you are. We in developed West don't have these limitations, so we are not so happy. Second extremely important feature, we all agreed on this. For people to be happy, you shouldn't have democracy which is taken seriously. Because if democracy really works, okay, even it doesn't really, if it works in the sense that ordinary people themselves experience themselves as the one who ultimately really decide their fate, that's not good, you worry too much. You have to have some figure of other political authority on whom you can put the blame for everything. And that was, in those dark years, the role of the Communist Party. As a friend from Czechoslovakia told me, even if the weather is like here, and I blame him, two, three days ago, all that storm and so on, oh, Chris is guilty, you know, fuck it, you know. Like, communists were blamed for everything. This makes, and I remember from my own country, it was a little bit of this. This makes life very easy, you know. Like, you know whom to blame. You don't feel responsible. This is second and third condition of happiness. You must have an image of paradise, of place where things are really good. And this paradise has to be at a proper distance. Not too close, not easily accessible, because if it is, then you see it's basically the same shit as where we are. But also not too distant, because then it's just a vague dream. They had it. It was West Germany, of course, you know. Because communist authorities in the 80s, at least, tolerated watching Western TV and so on and so on. I seriously think that all these three features constituted a kind of perfect happiness. Because at the same time, you know, it was no longer the old totalitarianism. You were allowed your private life, your niche. If you didn't mess with politics, it was relatively comfortable to live there. In this sense, to make a place further, I think that what disturbs happiness? Desire. By desire, I mean the force which compels you to move beyond, to disturb this fragile but nonetheless stability of happiness. To give an example that I use all the time. Let's say you live a relatively happy life, not being in love. Love is a catastrophe. You know, like, you drink with friends in the evening, maybe you have here and there one night stands and so on. Life is nice. Your job goes good. Then all of a sudden you fall passionately in love. Can you imagine a worst catastrophe? All the balance of your life is disturbed. You worry only about this. You are either jealous or nervous or whatever. You lose concentration for other things and so on and so on. Happiness is thus in itself confused, indeterminate. Very ambiguous notion. I like this German anecdote. A German immigrant to the United States is asked, are you happy? You know what's his answer? Yeah, yeah, I'm happy here, aber glücklich bin ich nicht. Like, it's not the same. So, I think that, now I will become a Christian, happiness is a pagan category. For pagans, the goal of life is to live a happy life. The idea to live happily ever after, I think, is a Christianized version of paganism. And religious experience and political activity themselves are considered the highest form of happiness. No wonder that Dalai Lama itself, and here I have problems with him, begins almost all his popular books with some kind of a gospel of happiness. He usually begins with all living beings strive towards towards happiness. My instant answer is maybe all living beings, but definitely not humans. If there is, and that's Freudian level.